I'm Sabella Beckman, professor of mathematics at the University of Georgia. Word problems really are the main goal of mathematics. If you think about why do we have math in the first place, it's really to be able to solve problems. The beauty of math is that we can have some rather simple, powerful ideas that are abstract to some extent, but because of their abstractness can be applied to a wide variety of seemingly rather different types of situations. And that's an extremely powerful thing about mathematics, but it's something that all students should learn to tap into. For students who are learning about word problems and solving word problems, it's often difficult to decide which operation to use, and perhaps there are several operations involved, but which operation applies where and to what part of the problem. And for students to be successful in solving problems, their teachers are going to need to pay direct, explicit attention to instruction on what type of problem is solved by what type of operation. It would be a mistake for teachers simply to rush headlong into always solving a problem or demonstrating how to solve a problem without discussing what it is that, how I can tell that this problem is solved by this particular operation as opposed to a different operation. Students don't always pick up on what it is that allowed the teacher to decide to make that choice that it was a division problem and not a multiplication problem or not a subtraction problem. It may be completely clear to the teacher or to older students. For younger students and students who are struggling, they really need to think through and develop some tools for making those choices. For example, with division, what kinds of problems can that solve? Well, if we're taking some big collection of things, or it doesn't even have to be a big collection of things, some collection of things, and dividing it equally into a certain number of groups, that's one type of division problem. So, for example, we might have 27 boys, and we're trying to put them into three equal groups to make three teams. How many boys should go in each group? That would be a simple story problem for 27 divided by 3. But another type of story problem for 27 divided by 3 would be, I have a piece of string, let's say, that's 27 feet long, and I want to know how many yards long is it. Well, each yard is 3 feet long, so to solve that problem, I need to know how many groups of 3 are in 27, and that's also another type of division story problem. For students to successfully be able to solve division problems, they'll need to have the idea of what kinds of problems can be solved by division. That's one of the challenges for students, to recognize what structure that problem is falling under. And teachers will have to pay explicit attention to those different types of problems. There's a temptation, I think, often for teachers to want to give students a simplified tool that may not be reliable, and that is the use of keywords. Keywords simply can't be a reliable way to solve problems all the time. So let me give a specific example. Let's think of a simple case. Let's say Tylisha had some stamps, and then she got 15 more stamps, and after that she had 37 stamps altogether. We can ask, how many stamps did Tylisha have at first? Students who hear the words altogether and more than in that problem statement will be tempted, if they're taught to use keywords, to add the numbers 15 and 37. Whereas if you think about the structure of the problem, there's an amount, there's an additional amount, and then there's that total. Well, we have to take that additional amount away from the total in order to determine the initial amount. So there's no substitute for actually understanding and making sense of that problem statement. And that might occur with the aid of some simple drawings or some kind of visual to support an understanding of that. But the use of keywords in particular is not reliable.